April 1975. American military helicopters airlift embassy personnel and evacuees from Saigon. For many, this is the final image of the Vietnam War. For those left behind, it's only the beginning. At first, the new communist government told them that little would change in their daily routines. If only that had been true.
At first, said that they just want peace, and they gradually started taking an inventory of all of our possessions, and then it could just continue to escalate to the point where my family literally lost everything and we were kicked out of our own homes.
At the time, Vinh Chung's family owned a rice milling business, one of the largest companies in the Mekong Delta, and the Viet Cong wanted their share. Within months, the government confiscated everything. And just like that, the Chung's empire was wiped out. With no job or house to go home to, the family gathered what little they had left and fled. Vinh was just 3 and a half at the time.
And then overnight, we lost everything. And so my parents saw that if they were to stay behind, regardless of how hard we worked, that at any moment, the communists could take it away. And it was at that point, knowing that leaving the country could potentially result in death, my parents realized that at that point it was worth the risk, because to stay behind, we had no future.
After the fall of Saigon, many of their fellow countrymen felt the same way. Thousands, if not millions, left when they could. So many of them went north to China that the Chinese closed its borders. Others who fled on land had to go west through the killing fields of Cambodia and Laos. The Chung family had one option, leave by sea, even though none of them had ever been on a boat or even seen the ocean.
We were allowed to take a small amount of money with us per person, but that was it. And so we decided to sell everything we had, get on this boat, go out to sea, and just hope for the best.
But shortly before they left, Vinh's mother had a strange dream.
And in the dream, she was in the marketplace as usual. But all of a sudden, she looked around and everyone was lying dead. And in the middle of the market, she also saw this bearded man. And whoever he would point to, they would come back up alive again. And so while lying there in her dream, she kept praying and wishing and hoping that this man would come and point at her and her family. And in her dream, this man did, and we all became alive again. And after the dream, she kept wondering what it was. And there was something about the dream that made her feel that it was more than just a dream.
Of the so-called Vietnamese boat people, only one out of every two survived. They left with barely any food or supplies, and those refugee boats were easy prey for Thai pirates.
And on these boats, little rickety boats, we had women, we had children, we had elderly people, and we were unarmed. So we were essentially a floating bank vault for these pirates, and they knew that.
And then, second day at sea, an ominous ship appeared over the horizon.
They just came in waving knives, little screwdrivers, and just anything. And they would just go around ripping earrings off of people, ripping jewelry off, demanding anything of value. After they robbed us, they left as quickly as they came, and they were off.
Now, refugees are people without countries, and the places where they seek asylum oftentimes get tired of them tying up their social services. So when the Chung family arrived on the shores after 3 long days at sea, they weren't exactly greeted by a welcoming committee.
The local villagers there had called the Malaysian military to report another boat of people showing up on their shores. They weren't sure what to do with us.
Less than an hour after arriving in Malaysia, armed soldiers took turns beating some of the men before ordering the entire group to march. And they did, for days and days under the hot sun.
They didn't tell us what would happen. They didn't tell us where we would go. We're basically in no man's land. There was no country that claimed us. we were in this complete state of limbo. The conditions were so brutal that my mother actually suffered a miscarriage. After a few days on the beach, she started bleeding to the point where she had passed out and almost died.
After 2 weeks, the Malaysian guards put the Chung family back on a boat and towed them out to sea. They said they were going to an island refugee camp. But a day later, with no land in sight, the Malaysians cut the ropes and told the refugees they were on their own.
We were betrayed and we were lied to, and then we were essentially left for dead. They did not want to accept us into the refugee camp. They also did not want to shoot us, but instead they did in the most passive way, putting us in a circumstance that would rid us from their shores, because in that circumstance, death is really the only reasonable outcome.
Dehydration begins when a body loses just 1 or 2% of its water reserves. Stranded in the South China Sea in the middle of July, Vin and his family reached that stage after only a day. After 5 days at sea, the refugees were about to die.
We had no food, we had no water. There were people who had gone blind because their corneas were scorched. There were people who were hallucinating. My grandfather started hallucinating, and the women on board actually contemplated drowning their own children, because perhaps that would be the way that would minimize the suffering that they would have to undergo. And my father looked around and saw his children and his whole family dying. And so he got on his knees and prayed to the Creator God. And almost immediately, the clouds came in and water came out of the sky.
The rain helped them survive, but it wasn't going to help them live. The refugees needed another miracle. And thankfully, theirs was just a few miles away.
We see a large white ship. We didn't know if this ship would be another pirate ship, but by now we were so desperate that it didn't matter. And I remember the adults were telling everyone to lie down, so that we could look sick and get some more sympathy from the crew on this ship. It's kind of funny now to think about trying to act sick or desperate, because we were near death.
2 years earlier, the president of World Vision, a man named Stan Mooneyham, bought an old cargo ship and began trawling the miles and miles of empty waters for refugees. He called it Operation Sea Sweep. On July 9, 1979, Sea Sweep spotted Vin and his half-dead family bobbing up and down hundreds of miles from shore.
They're packed in there like sardines. Just literally chock-a-block. Oh, man.
The refugees were brought on board and given food, blankets, and Bibles. Vin's father was invited to attend a service held by the crew.
It was at that moment that he understood that this is the God that brought rain down to quench our thirst when we needed it.
This was our time to say to God that we thank Him for making it possible for us to meet together.
And it is also this God that had been working all this time to bring this crew from World Vision on this white boat to come out and rescue them.
At the time, President Jimmy Carter declared that any refugees picked up by a U.S.-owned ship would be guaranteed asylum in the United States. So within months after being rescued, Vin and his family arrived at their new home in Fort Smith, Arkansas. Soon, they found a place where they could fit in, a church that offered a Vietnamese language service. The Chungs decided to attend and couldn't believe what they saw.
In the church, my mother saw a framed picture of Jesus. And when she looked at that picture, she thought, that was a man in my dream. His name was Jesus. And he is a man who brings someone back to life, that someone could die and have a new life through him.
The Chung family made the most of America. His father worked long hours to support his family of 10. Vin studied hard and graduated high school valedictorian. From there, he went to Harvard to become a doctor. And a few years ago, he went back to Vietnam. There, he met some cousins and relatives, his family that didn't make it out.
I visited thatch roof huts with no electricity, no running water. I think at that point was when I realized that even though I had worked long and hard to get to where I was, it was really through no merit of my own. What really struck me at that point was Luke 12, verse 48, to whom much is given, much is expected. I'd never thought that that verse applied to me. I'd always thought that Jesus was talking about the rich or maybe the powerful people who could have an influence and have something to give. But when I was in Vietnam, I was able to see that everything that we have, regardless of how much or how little, has been given to us, and that we are stewards of all of our resources, all of our opportunities, and our potential influence for the kingdom of God.
Vin arrived in America with just the clothes on his back. He worked long and hard, and now he had to repay the favor.
When I look back at the journey that my family went through to go from Vietnam to this country, I have no doubt that God sent the boat. Now that I have been rescued, now that I'm safely on shore, my obligation is to send the boat back to those people who are in need.
Today, Vinh Chung is doing just that. He lives in Colorado Springs with his wife and children. He owns and operates his own practice as a dermatologist. He also serves on the board at World Vision, the same organization that saved his life more than 30 years ago. And after a journey that took him 10,000 miles across two continents, he's finally home.